All right, so capital management, that's chapter 15. We got two more chapters left. This and one more to finish. Chapter 15. Capital management. And capital management addresses the problem of solvency and solvency risk.
Hello.
So we begin with the most basic definitions for capital, which is simply funds or resources contributed by owners of the business, in this case financial institution. So these are owners' funds placed at risk or invested at risk. And the two main forms of capital will be external, which is sale of stock, and internal, which is retained earnings. All right. So, what do we have? Section 1. And section 1 is simply functions. What are the main functions of capital? Functions is the same as a role or task. So what's the role of capital? Number one, is cushion against failure, is in bankruptcy, failure. Well, technically we say against now, this is the same cushion is absorbs losses. Again, this is where we started the course, is that whenever you have a loss for all businesses, not just banks, any business, the loss goes against owner's capital. In this particular case, owner's capital for a financial institution got a special name. We call it bank capital. Now that's number one. Second function is startup funding. Applies again for all businesses, banks, non-banks. Capital is needed to start the business. So no matter what business you want, you need a little bit of capital. Maybe if it's your own business on internet, only a laptop and internet connection. If it's going to be a small shop, You will also need some capital to rent the space, okay? Maybe you'll need capital to hire the initial employees. If it's a more specialized shop, you'll need capital to buy machines and equipment before you begin operations to generate revenue. You have what's called startup funding. This is the same as initial capital. And when it comes to starting a business, it's very difficult to sell stock for a business that doesn't exist. Business needs to be up, running, generating some revenue, have potential for growth, and only then investors will buy stock, okay? So initially, we call these entrepreneurs, will put money out of their pocket. Number three is it as or boosts, promotes public confidence.
Boosts public confidence.
Public, yes. It boosts, it promotes or produces public confidence. So a business, any business with a lot of owner's equity is considered to be low risk, and the public has confidence in businesses that have a lot of capital. Now, businesses that are considered to have a lot of capital or sufficient relative to its assets, obligations, and whatnot is called, such a business is called well capitalized. Well capitalized. Now remember, a business is insolvent when assets are less than liabilities. So well capitalized businesses have a lot more assets than liabilities. So no matter what happens, they can sell assets to service the debt. And well-capitalized businesses are usually the public has confidence in those businesses. Capital is also used for, similar to number two, to develop new products and services. So if you want to introduce a new service, you need capital. It comes from capital. Now, here it's not in the textbook, but it's clearly this part is research. And development. Well, in this case, it's just a playing with words. Development means the innovation of new products and new services and introducing them to the customer. So that's where it's done with capital. Let's see what else. An important function of capital is to regulate growth, as in bank growth. Why? For example, regulators require that the bank has at least 10% capital and 90% equity. So if the bank grows assets by 20%, equity must grow by 20%, capital must grow by 20%. If you want to grow by 30% the bank assets, the equity must grow by 30%. So the bank must somehow, in some way, find capital to grow faster. Otherwise, it will become, it's called decapitalized. Decapitalized. Is a business or any financial institution or any kind of business whose capital levels are very low, significantly low. Let's see what else we got. It provides an interesting role in mergers and acquisitions. If a business has a lot of capital, it's easier to make a merger or acquisition. If business has very little capital, it's a lot easier to be acquired. So you have one company which acquires and another company which just acquires. If you want to be acquired, if you're well capitalized, it's easy to acquire. If you're decapitalized, you're more likely to be easily acquired. Okay?
Can you say this is expansion?
Yeah, this is a type of expansion. So the business can expand.
If it is well capitalized. The business can expand if it is well capitalized.
Correct. So this will be for both growth. So this is an alternative form of growth. Growth is said to be organic when the business grows steadily on its own. The alternative growth is external. And again, don't confuse external growth with external capital. External growth means by buying another business. In other words, with a merger or with an acquisition. All right. And the last main function specific to banks, financial, and especially depository institutions has the function to protect deposit insurance. In other words, the government will usually provide deposit insurance to depositors if banks go bankrupt. Well, more capital is usually protecting the business against insolvency or bankruptcy and reduces the chance of losses to the government in case of bankruptcy. All right, so the main purpose of capital is associated with risk. So the next section, number 2, is again, first and foremost function is to absorb losses. Well, losses come from risk. So you have capital and risk. So capital protects against the following risks. And again, that's why we studied the things before. Now it's very easy. I'll just write the main risks. It protects against losses in credit or credit risk. It provides an important cushion against liquidity risk. Again, I was explaining this a while ago that if business becomes illiquid and gets in liquidity trouble, it can borrow or acquire liquidity more easily if it has a lot of capital, meaning if it is well capitalized, it can quickly borrow liquidity. If a bank is decapitalized, it's very hard, meaning no one will want to lend to a decapitalized or sometimes you say undercapitalized bank. Undercapitalized is the same as decapitalized. So it is very important protection against liquidity risk. Phone, just put it on the front of the desk so I can see it.
No, it's okay.
Is it okay?
No, because I got the session.
Number three, it protects against interest rate risk. If interest rate rises, a lot of the assets will fall in value. So it provides a cushion against rising interest rates and interest rate risk. Number four, operational risk. And maybe a couple more. Yes. It protects against exchange rate risk. And there's one other. It's sometimes classified as a operational risk. But here they put in a brand new one. It's called a crime risk, which is risk against
fraud.
Yes, fraud. Employees stealing, hackers stealing. Okay, and there is one special, which is a robbery.
How is it fully capitalized to protect from robbery?
Well, it does not protect from robbery, but if there is a robbery, if it's decapitalized, the robbery would, it just goes to bankruptcy. In other words, the idea is that when the thieves come, they are going to steal less than the existing capital. Okay? Because the bank, there aren't very many assets that you can steal from the bank. There's just one asset to steal.
Cash.
That's it. And if cash is less than the capital, okay, let's say the bank maintains 8% capital but only 6% cash. Even if they steal all the cash in the bank, they still have enough capital to protect the bank from bankruptcy. We call it from, again, insolvency. Okay? So, and also, even if the bank has cash, the cash will not be all in one place. It will be spread around. And remember, cash position includes two things. It includes cash itself and deposits at the central bank. And these can't really be stolen. Okay, it's not cash that thieves can steal. Robbery, and there's one more, it's called an embezzlement. Well, you need to open the dictionary. Well, now is the time to get the phone and use it productively. Okay? It's basically to embezzle, EMB.
Double Z?
Yes, double Z. Basically means employees trying to, you know, stealing. Yes, it's a theft by employees.
It's one type of fraud.
Yes, it's right. It's fraud. It's theft, but it's theft by employees. Hey! Well, I'm trying to teach. Okay, you should be coming on time.
Okay, but we finished chapter 12?
Yes, we finished it, and now here
we jump. 15. We jump to chapter 15.
Yes.
There's no chapter 14 and 15.
No. That's why I'm saying you need.
But from the beginning.
Yes.
Yeah, I didn't have the chapter with me.
Okay.
That's the part.
Right. I have written chapter 15. So we have our chapter 15. Again, you worry about these things later. You're coming late, you're becoming now extremely disruptive. So as a reward, let's make sure you get an absence, right? Same for you.
Alright,
so these are the risks.
Hello?
Yes,
we'll move. I came in, but I didn't start because I don't want to interrupt you.
Alright. We continue. Defenses. Number one. Quality management. So the first basis, quality management. You try to operate things properly. You try to minimize risks. You try to manage liquidity. You try to manage properly credit and credit risk. In other words, don't make as many bad loans. You try to manage interest rate risk. You try to manage your risks properly and minimize losses. So the first thing is quality of management and quality management. Okay. Here they define in management, quality management is ability to deal with problems quickly and efficiently. Deal with problems early before they become big problems. Diversification has two main branches. Number one is portfolio. Portfolio diversification is you have different institutions, different types of securities, different types of industries, maybe even different countries, okay? And then there is a specific one, this part of the country is called geographic. Usually geographies can suffer the whole geography, a particular state can suffer. For example, in Thailand, they have a couple of areas which are subject to a tsunami. If you lend only to those tsunami-prone area, when the tsunami comes, it affects your business. So you don't want to be more than 10 or 20% exposed to that particular geographic area. So try to spread. So in the United States, that will mean across different states. You don't want to be just lending in one state. And if the state economy crashes for any reason, your bank crashes with it. Next. Deposit insurance. This is usually provided by the government. It provides some confidence so that that depositors don't get easily scared. And the last protection, if nothing else works, is, of course, bank capital. So, we covered at the beginning the functions of capital, then we explained the connection of capital and risk, how to protect in general. The next section, 4, becomes, let's see, somehow, capital and risk, that's actually section. This is technically introduction, section 1. This is technically section 2. This is 3. Next section is types of capital. Well, I already gave you the simple classification of being external and...
But put in question, put this is in question, both 1 and 2. Could be in a question...
What is the question?
Yes.
Oh, what are the main functions of capital? What are the main functions of capital? It's also same as purpose. What is the purpose of capital?
Say, okay.
Alright. What's the purpose? What does it do? It's like, what's the purpose of mouth? Well, talking and eating, right? What's the purpose of ears? What's the function of ears? Listening. Function of eyes. Vision, right?
What regarding this?
Well, this is capital and risk. What's the connection between capital and risk? Well, it's actually capital protects against all risks. I gave you 15 risks before. These are the 4
functions
between capital and risk. The connection between capital and risk. So, what are the main types of capital?
You just need to know basic stuff. Number 1,
common stock.
Number 2,
preferred stock. Preferred stock will have a preferred dividend. The dividend is usually fixed, let's say 5% or whatever value it is. The common stock could be any dividend or no dividend at all.
Number 1 is risky, the other one is like most safer. Right?
Yes, that's what you're going to get with your next quiz. So, common stock is a lot riskier and preferred stock is a lot less risky. Now, common stock has a chance to grow the dividend while the preferred stock, the dividend is fixed. So, common stock has a higher risk and potential for higher expected return. Next one is called surplus. And that should call it surplus capital. This is the following. For example, if there is a preferred stock with a face value of 100 and it's sold for 120, the 20, which is the price above the face value, becomes surplus. So the surplus capital again comes from the owners themselves, from the stock. Next one is undivided profits. And undivided profits, we just call it retained earnings. And retained earnings is associated with what we call internal growth or organic growth. That's retained earnings. Next one is called equity. Reserves. And these are simply reserves in case of emergency or in case of, I explained before, contingency. Contingency capital, okay? In case something happens, maybe there's a legal action, maybe there's a fraud, robbery, theft, embezzlement, okay? Something bad happens, just in case. But sometimes even they say loan loss reserves. Next one is a little trickier. Six. Subordinated debenture. Now, debenture means a bond. And it is unsecured bond. Well, now comes a very hard question. What if it is a bond and that's a liability? Okay. If it's a bond and it's a liability, why does it count as capital? It's a tough question. The answer is, if it's unsecured, if it's a bond, and if it's subordinated, means that it will be paid after all depositors. So, subordinated means it will not be paid until all depositors are fully paid. And therefore, it functions as a protection. So this main purpose is provides protection to depositors. It's still a protection or cushion against depositors. And therefore, it's kind of like half-half. Now there is one, next one is very tricky. Minority interest in consolidated, whatever. I'm not gonna cover, it's very tricky. If a bank owns another bank, okay? So, if you own another bank, the other bank will have, let's say, certain capital. Let's say 10% capital. So, if the bank has a size of 10 million balance sheet, it has a 1 million in equity, okay? If you own 10% of that, then you technically own 10% of 1 million equity, which is 100,000. So you'll add that one. Not very interesting. Next one is more interesting and tricky. It's called equity commitment note. Equity commitment note. Well, if it's a note, it means that it's a bond, the same as bond, the same as obligation. So technically, it is a liability. But equity commitment means the following. The bond is convertible to stock. Okay. And it's called, it's mandatory. Mandatory convertible. So an equity commitment note is the same as a mandatory convertible bond. So what's a mandatory convertible bond? It is a bond that will be paid back in the future with stock. So the obligation is to issue stock and give stock to the bond holder. So the promise is, for example, the bond with a face value of, let's say, $1,000 will have a, let's call it in English, in finance is called conversion ratio is, let's say, 20, means that you will get 20 shares of stock for one bond. But you're not going to get them now, you're going to get them when the bond matures. So when the bond matures, if it's mandatory convertible, if it will be converted in the future, but if it will be converted, then it counts as capital. Okay. So even though it's a bond, if it will be converted in the future, it counts as stock. So it's kind of like in between. It's in between. We call these in between, we call them, anybody?
In between?
In between debt and equity. It has a special name, a security, which has characteristics of both debt and equity. Now, this is also highly protective of depositors. We call that kind of security a hybrid. Hybrid security is a security which has characteristics of both debt and equity. One such security is a convertible bond. Okay. Well, these subordinated debentures are functioning as equity too, meaning they're protecting the depositors. So these are the main types. So now that these are the types that exist, the question is simply, which are the most important in practice? The most important in practice will be, most important is number one, common stock, very important. Number two has become relatively important. Surplus capital is not very important, but the most important, especially for small banks, is retained earnings. Retained earnings is the most important source of capital for small banks. Okay. And then equity reserves is always small. Six and seven are only for large, reputable, well-established banks can enjoy other sources of capital. All right, subordinated debt has an important function. has an important function. Number six. Has an important function. The function of market discipline. Well, what does it mean? This means the following. Subordinated debt is usually associated with very large banks. Very large banks will have relatively little capital. Small banks will have relatively large percentage of capital. And subordinated debt is issued mostly by big, large banks in big size quantities, usually into billions of dollars, and subordinated debt will be traded. And if it's traded, subordinated debt will have a price, a market price. And the market price will provide a market signal. If subordinated debt price begins to fall, it will indicate that there is a significant increased risk in the bank, the market. It has significant increased risk in the bank. So, subordinated debt turns out to be the most sensitive instrument that the bank may be in trouble. And if subordinated debt beginning to fall usually tells management immediately that they are in trouble. When subordinated debt falls, stockholders in a meeting will call management and say, you guys are in trouble. What's the problem? And how are you going to fix it? Or they'll just throw management away and put a better manager. In other words, it provides a signal that something is potentially wrong, or at least that the market perceives that the bank is not well managed for some reason. Usually, management always come back and say the same thing, always. They say, we're good, we're very good, we don't have trouble, we don't have problem. They, meaning the market, everybody else, the rest of the world is stupid enough not to see how good bank we are. And usually management is wrong. Usually they're lying because they're scared for their jobs. All right, so that's the market discipline story. All right, next section is number four. The next section is regulation, regulatory approach, regulation. What is the function, purpose of regulation? Why banks have regulation, regulatory? Approach. So, why there is regulation and there is simple, easy, straightforward answer? The answer is called contagion. Banks need regulation and capital to make sure that capital is high and sufficient. And if capital is not sufficient, the contagion effect means that if one bank goes bankrupt, it's always big news everywhere in the world. America, Japan, Sudan, and Bulgaria. In Bulgaria, we had a bank in trouble. The first thing that all media went, there were like hundreds of cameras, and everybody does the same thing. The bank is in trouble. And when that happened 4 or 5 years ago, it was all within less than a minute on Facebook. The whole Facebook exploded. The activity of Facebook for 10 minutes was equivalent to a week worth of activity, because the bank's going bankrupt. The guy calls his wife and says, drop everything, get the hell out of where you are, and run to the bank. Get the money now. Don't wait 30 minutes or 1 hour. In 30 minutes, there will not be any money in the bank. Okay? Well, guess what happens? The next 10 minutes...
Bad things, contagion.
Yes, contagion means that if one
is sick...
Well, no, if the bank is sick, it will make the other banks sick too. So, as soon as half of the country rushed to the one bank, immediately, within 10, 20, 30 minutes, you get to see long lines of customers to all other banks, which were thought to be similar like this one. So, the problem is that as soon as there is a bank lineup in one bank, like one bank, 10 other banks are now under attack, meaning you have a bank run. Bank run. Contagion means if I have a disease, you can get the disease from me. You become sick from my disease because you're similar to me, near by me.
I get the disease
from somebody else. So this is contagion effect associated with banks, commercial banks. So if one bank falls, no big deal. Problem is people rush and usually the whole banking system collapses. So the regulators have to be very careful not to allow even one bank to fall. So, what are the purposes, the goals of regulation? Number one, limit bank failures. Limit bank failures. The second one is, of course, somewhere over here, preserve public confidence, boost it. Always the same, when a bank is in serious trouble, they always come out to the media and always say the same thing. We have all the capital necessary. We satisfy all capital requirements. They always come back and say, we're very well capitalized. And the public is supposed to believe it. And most of the times the public is stupid enough and actually believes it. Okay? But sometimes they don't trust banks and they just say, okay, but if you have capital, just give me my money back. What's the problem, right? Just give me my money back and you still keep your capital, right? My money is an obligation. You should be able, if you're well capitalized, you should be able to return my money back and still have all the capital, right? And the public is also perfectly correct. The problem is that the bank may have plenty of capital and still not have enough cash to return the money to depositors. So that's the second function. And number three, to limit losses to government deposit, insurance. So, function 7 was to preserve deposit insurance. So, what the government does is says you need to maintain at least 8% capital, and by this way, the government itself protects its deposit insurance fund, hoping that it will not need it in the first place. So, now we're back to your question. The question is, what's the question? Right? The question is, what's the question?
The question is, there's a function.
Yeah. Why does government regulate banks? So, why does it?
To limit the banks.
To limit bank failures, to boost or increase public confidence, and to limit its own losses. Deposit insurance. All right. Now, we, or at least here, are not going to cover now. There are international standards. There are international regulatory standards where many big governments, like US, UK, France, Germany, Japan, whatever, get together to make or to have uniform standards on capital. And the first international standard was made in Switzerland,
Basel.
In Basel. Yes, and it's called Basel I. That was the first one. Basel I was, I think, what is it, 86? Let's check. No, 88. 1988. Again, they may agree in 1 year and then they'll implement it over the next 5 or 10 years.
Okay.
Basel II, I think it was 2004, I'm not so sure. Let's take a look. Where's Basel II?
The big company makes uniform to regulate banking.
Yes, uniform requirements or regulation for banks throughout the world, or at least similar. Let's see, where's Basel II? 2004, and I haven't checked, there is already Basel III, what the year is. This again is advanced, very difficult material, very complex. Even bankers don't understand it very well. You need banker slash lawyer slash financier to understand all of these. So we're not going to go through this. And we'll just write, what are the main principles of regulation? So what are the principles of regulation? Let's see a little bit. So principles of regulation are three. The first principle is minimum capital requirements. That's the first big one. So they do whatever so that at the end of the day, most banks will have 8% or so capital. Well, they divide it into tier 1 and tier 2, and they gotta have at least 4% of tier 1 and at least 8% of tier 2. But at least there are. This is the first main primary purpose goal of the regulation. Second one is a supervision.
This is for what you said?
For Basel. For Basel. Second one is banks will be supervised. The regulator will be required, let's say, every year year or every 2 years to review the following. So the central bank or whoever the regulator is will have a requirement how often to supervise the bank. It's called to audit, okay? And what to look for in the audit. So they standardize. In other words, the banks have to be supervised. You don't just put regulation. Like here, you're coming to school and supposedly you pay attention, occasionally playing the phone, but it has to be an exam. And the exam says how well you do. Here, it has to be. It's actually supervision. They actually call it, the people who do the exam are called bank examiner. Examiner. They call bank examiner. And they call it
bank auditor.
Yes, for bank auditor. The auditors will be bank examiners called. So there's an exam. They gotta pass the exam. They go through tests.
Statement, yes.
Yes.
If from central bank or from...
Yes, the central bank. So there are two audits, two exams. One audit is called accounting audit. The accounting audit's got one purpose, only to check that the balance sheet is correct, correctly reflects the reality. Then there will be regulatory exam to satisfy, to make sure that all the regulatory requirements like capital is satisfied. And number three, the third big is greater disclosure. Let's write it in red. Disclosure. Disclosure is publishing important information relative to the business. So the bank will disclose its futures derivatives. It will disclose its options derivatives. It will disclose in very great detail all off balance sheet positions. It will disclose in great detail their understanding of the different risks. So it will provide requirements for disclosure. If the information is disclosed, then the market will be a good regulator. There are a lot of investors, funds, who will read the statements and they'll say, oh, they'll read everything that's disclosed in the statements. And again, a disclosure could easily be for a bank, but 50 pages, 100 pages.
This one regulated that to protect bank from adventures.
Well, yeah, we call these adventures, we call them risk. So here, the disclosure is that investors at least know what the risks are. Then they will decide if the bank is good and buy the stock, or if the risks are too high and sell the stocks. So, as long as the information is available, the market will react and provide market discipline. So, number three makes this market discipline function better. And let's see, I have one little section. Okay. There are two more. They're small. Let's first write out the legal, technical, according to law and regulation, the proper and correct terminology for capitalization.
The legal, what's the question?
Proper terminology on capitalization. I'll explain now, it's very easy. The first is called capitalized. This is the highest form of capital where the bank is considered well protected. It has more than enough. Number two, adequately capitalized. So, adequately capitalized means it has enough capital. Well capitalized has more than enough. One, two, three. Three is under capitalized. It has, but it's not quite enough. It's significant, but not sufficient, not good enough. Then it's significantly undercapitalized. This is well below required. Significantly. Significantly capitalized. And the lowest level is critically.
Capitalized.
Under capitalized. Critically capitalized means it is in real serious danger of insolvency. So this is the lowest level, means it's pretty much close to zero. Okay? And of course you can add one more. You can add one more. They have not added, it's called insolvent. Simply means it has a negative capital, the same as liabilities. So, negative capital, just a little above, but far from sufficient, significantly undercapitalized is. So, instead of, let's say, for tier one, if it's 4% legal requirements, here, well capitalized means it's got 5, even though four is required. Adequately capitalized required 4, they have 4. Undercapitalized will be required 4, they have 3. Significantly undercapitalized, they'll have only 2. Critically undercapitalized, they may have 1%. And insolvent is less than 0. Okay? And let's finish here. I have one very small section on capital management, which is basically how to meet capital needs. And you can meet capital needs two ways, internally and externally. It will take about 10 or 15 minutes, but I'll cover next time.